I titled the talk Dhaka, City of 100 Villages. If one has lived in Dhaka and you've spent some time there, you would see that it's very rural. It's actually a city of contradictions, because it's a city of great economic enterprise. You know, one would see its immense opportunities it offers, especially in the ready-made garment sector, real estate and retail, which is why many Indians as well are there, you know, harnessing economic opportunities. But it's also a city of which is really precariously short of economic infrastructure, especially with energy and water concerns. But if you look at an average Dhakaite, you know, someone living in Dhaka, they're very strongly connected to their village. I mean, not just the village space, but the kinship obligations they take with them from the village. It's supposed to be the fastest growing megacity in the world, as according to the World Bank. It really defies some of our assumptions on urbanization or theories of modern urban development because of these contradictions. So, you know, where one expects that an individual who migrates to the city becomes somehow a liberal individual, living for themselves, having rational economic choices, nothing of that works in Dhaka. And that really explains how the city runs every day, how it's governed every day. So that's one major concern, the unlivability of Dhaka, as it were. And it's, if one looks through the papers in Dhaka, there's a lot of alarmist articles on, you know, pretty much this is a city. But the second concern is the rapid pace at which the city's grown. I mean, it's in the last 10 years, the population has grown fourfold. And it's estimated that there are about 30 million people living in Dhaka. So the first is, of course, it puts down the government's problems of Dhaka, as it were, to a demographic chaos. Right? The city has grown far too rapidly for it to cope with this immigration. But the second is also, there's a lot of urban primacy in Dhaka, I mean, in a way that it's difficult to compare it with India, actually, because most of the formal employment opportunities are in Dhaka. It offers 50% formal employment, which is very high. But if one looks at the fundamental governance problem of Dhaka, it is that 50% of the people living in Dhaka are invisible to urban policy making. And that's really the core of Dhaka's governance challenges, right? Or why it is the way it is. Now, where does this exclusion begin? Right? Pretty much from the point at which official record keeping begins. Right? So if we look at the census, it counts only formal households, people renting or living in formal households. It does not count people living in, for instance, the informal settlements. The second is, if you look at administrative maps, it doesn't show you the slums. Right? It goes down to the very minutest thana level, which is the smallest, thana is equivalent to a police station. It puts all of that, but you don't see is that around Kirani Ganj, there's a huge slum. You don't see that around certainly the cantonment in the Mirpur area, which is where the garments industry is, there are lots of slums. So you've got Uttara, Tongi, even Bhushanpara. This is an elite part of Dhaka, where there are slums servicing these neighborhoods. So you can see that a major part of Dhaka is not part of urban planning. Because of this, the fact that a number of people in Dhaka are not included, what you have to think about in governance terms is that every day people have to find ways of coping. So this is what takes place. So what you can see is that the establishment of these slums, the organization of these slums, as well as the way in which services are accessed, are certainly you know, are organized through, you know, intermediaries and so on, but they're also linked politically. So they're not important to policy, but they're important to politics. If you look at rickshaws in policy terms, they are seen as an irritant, right? Rickshaws you have to think of as another type of coping mechanism. So you have migrants coming in, and this is one of the ways of getting access to the informal economy. So even though they don't pay taxes to the public exchequer, they are actually hierarchically organized through a system of rent seeking. And one of the major concerns of Dhaka now is the rise of urban crime. What we were allowed to see, and in a sense then it began to make sense, is that the highest level crimes reported were actually hijacking and extortion of rickshaw pullers and the auto rickshaw drivers. That was highest. So what we see therefore is a kind of, you know, a level of violence which is actually implicated by this form of governance, the politics of decentralization in Bangladesh. And it has been one where successive governments have introduced a policy for decentralization only for the next government to remove it. Because, I mean, the thing with Bangladesh is it's very difficult to distinguish between the state and the political party power. Their interests commute very much, okay? So what happens is when a party comes into power, the approach really is what is kind of become a rhetoric in Bangladesh is a winner-takes-all approach, right? So the party that comes into power pretty much has to control every aspect of public administration, from the local governments to the judiciary, to the civil service recruitment, to the way in which the national media is run, everything. So the decentralization policy has been very much a victim of this kind of politics. And that's it. I mean, we started the South Asia Urban Research Network, and we're looking at coming up with more reports every 2 years. Like I said, Bangladesh, but also South Asia. I'm sure there will be synergies with your own experiences to hear about that as well. Thank you.